Welcome to First Lutheran Church, where you're among friends in Christ. I'm Reverend Thomas Rothe. I'm glad you've joined us today, and it's my prayer that the Holy Spirit, working through the gospel, touches your heart and changes your life. May the Lord bless you today and throughout the rest of the week. Our first, or Old Testament, lesson is recorded in the Old Testament book of Isaiah. We read the 55th chapter, beginning at the 6th verse. I invite you to follow along with the readings of the lessons. They're printed on the back side of this morning's bulletin. God's plan to save sinners is so lofty that natural man just can't comprehend it. It is a plan of pure mercy and free pardon. The only hope for sinners is to abandon their proud, self-righteous thoughts and receive God in His time and on His terms. We read, "Seek the Lord while He may be found. Call on Him while He is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and He will have mercy on them, and to our God, for He will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." Here ends our first lesson. Today's second lesson is recorded in Paul's letter to the Philippians. We read the first chapter beginning at the 18th verse. From prison, St. Paul speaks of the joyful tension in which a Christian lives. On the one hand, we long to be with Christ in heaven. On the other hand, we are happy to serve Christ while here on earth. May God give us the courage and willingness to exalt our Savior in life and in death. We read. The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached, and because of this, I rejoice. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and God's provision of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet, what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. But it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain, and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your boasting in Christ Jesus will abound on account of me. Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in the one Spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel. Here ends our second lesson. Alleluia! My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Alleluia. The gospel lesson for the day, which will also serve as our sermon text, is recorded in the Gospel of St. Matthew. We read the 20th chapter, beginning at the first verse. Here we're reminded that God's kingdom comes to different people at different times. The reward is the same for all, because it is a reward of grace, not personal accomplishment. Working God's kingdom, be it short or long, is truly a privilege of grace. Those who take issue with God's grace will find themselves last, that is, outside of his grace. We read, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. He agreed to pay them a denarius for the day and sent them out into the vineyard. About 9 in the morning, he went out and saw others standing in the marketplace doing nothing. He told them, 'You also go and work in my vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. He went out again about noon and about 3 in the afternoon and did the same thing. About 5 in the afternoon, he went and found still others standing around. He asked them, 'Why have you been standing here all day long, doing nothing?' 'Because no one has hired us,' they answered. He said to them, 'You also go and work in my vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, 'Call the workers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired and going on to the first.' The workers who were hired about 5 in the afternoon came, and each received a denarius. So when those who were hired first, they expected to receive more. But each one of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. These who were hired last worked only 1 hour, they said, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the work and the heat of the day.' But he answered one of them, 'I am not being unfair to you. Friend, didn't you agree to work for a denarius? Take your pay and go. I want to give the ones who was hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last.' Here ends our gospel lesson."
Thank you.
grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Once again, our sermon text for this morning is the gospel lesson for the day. Dear friends in Christ, for those of you who are competitive, why do you compete? You want to finish first. Maybe you were competitive with your brothers and sisters growing up. The first one into the living room gets to select the channel on TV. Or maybe you were competitive with other student athletes on the diamond field or court. Or maybe you were competitive with other job seekers trying to land that ideal job. The reason you compete is because you want to finish first. The portion of God's word that we have before us this morning has a hint of competition to it. Different individuals are taking different paths, but striving for the same thing, to finish first. This morning, then, let's meditate on the theme, who doesn't want to finish first? We'll see, first of all, that some who think that they are ahead are actually coming in last. And secondly, some who think they are behind are really coming in first. Just prior to our sermon text, Peter said to Jesus, "We have left everything to follow you. What then will there be for us?" Jesus' reply was that there would be rewards. Rewards that were often misinterpreted and oftentimes fell short of human expectation. What were the rewards that Jesus was promising his followers? Heaven and all its blessings. But what did some of the people think were the rewards? A heaven here on earth, complete with a restoration of Israel's former glory, freedom from Roman tyranny, and also that land flowing with milk and honey. That kind of thinking and expectation just didn't jive with Jesus' thinking or his expectant end result. Our sermon text tells us, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. He agreed to pay them a denarius for the day and sent them into his vineyard. So when those came who were hired first, they expected to receive more. But each one of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. These who were hired last worked only 1 hour, they said. And you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the work and the heat of the day." In describing the reward of heaven to his followers, Jesus uses the word like and speaks in parable form. Remember, a parable was a teaching tool that Jesus used. It taught a truth about the kingdom of heaven using an earthly story. He says that heaven is like a landowner gathering workers for his vineyard. But some of those workers turned out to be grumblers. They weren't content to receive what the landowner had promised to give them. They thought that their reward should be greater. You see, they wanted to finish first in wage earnings. What did the landowner promise to give each person who worked in his vineyard? We're told a denarius, or a day's wage. It didn't matter if they worked all of the day or just part of the day. The landowner was a man of his word, and he wanted to reward each equally. But those grumblers, instead of being content with what they received from the landowner, they wanted more. They thought that they were ahead, but were really coming in last. Let me explain. Do you sometimes expect extra rewards from God for living an extra good life? Or do you sometimes expect rewards because you've been a Christian your whole life long? Don't hold your breath. The rewards that you're looking for are not the rewards that Jesus is about to give. Instead of thinking with your head, start thinking with your heart. Latch on to those rewards that the Apostle Paul latched onto. He said, "My," referring to God, "my grace is sufficient for you." To think that you're ahead of everyone else in that line to receive God's reward really means that you're at the end of that line. Our sermon text continues. About 9 in the morning he went out and saw others standing in the marketplace doing nothing. He said to them, "You also go and work in my vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. He went out again about noon and about 3 in the afternoon and did the same thing. About 5 in the afternoon, he went out and found still others standing around. He asked them, "Why have you been standing here all day long doing nothing?" "Because no one has hired us," they answered. He said to them, "You also go and work in my vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Call the workers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired and going on to the first." The workers who were hired about 5 in the afternoon came, and each received a denarius. "I am not being unfair to you, friend. Didn't you agree to work for a denarius? Take your pay and go. I want to give the one who was hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last." Did you ever wonder how the other workers must have felt when they heard the grumblers demanding more but didn't get it? My guess is that some of you might be thinking, "Oh, that's just too bad." But I'm also guessing that others of you might be thinking that they felt that they maybe didn't deserve the same reward as the others. Maybe they thought that they were behind the others in that line to receive God's reward, but were really at the head of the line. What is God's thinking on this whole matter? Well, just as the landowner in the parable invited everyone he could to join him and work in the vineyard, and then reward each equally, God does the same. He invites everyone to join him in his kingdom of heaven. And he promises to reward each freely and equally. Not on the basis of seniority or on how much work got done, but on the basis of grace and his gift of faith. While we live out our life here on this earth, we're going to have both human reason and faith. In order to have faith stand strong and not give in to reason, we will need to remain close to God and his word. God's word, both in the written and spoken form, as well as in the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, will mold our mind to be more like God's mind. Let me ask you this. What will a person who doesn't have the mind of God do when someone hits them? Most likely, hit them back. But the person who has the mind of God will turn the other cheek, as Scripture encourages. Now, I'm not saying that that would happen all the time, because while we live out our life here on this earth, we're always going to have that sinful human nature that's always going to be trying to suppress the will of God. And sometimes that sinful human nature will win out. But not if we remain close to God and his word, in both written, spoken form, and the sacraments. How can you ensure that your faith will win out? Have God's word, as preached from this pulpit, read from that lectern, received in the sacrament of Holy Communion, strengthen the faith that the Holy Spirit has planted in your heart at baptism. Have the word as you read it at home. Strengthen the faith in the Holy Spirit and continue to strengthen it, that faith that finds its home in your heart. Have the Holy Spirit working through your witnessing and fellowshipping, strengthen the faith that you have in your heart and in the hearts of others. Who doesn't want to finish first? We all do. Some who think that they are ahead are really coming in last. And some who think they are behind are really coming in first. The way to get into heaven is only through Jesus, because he is the way, the truth, and the life. To stay on that path and finished first is due solely to God's grace and his gift of faith. May God the Holy Spirit continue to lead us to that gate right into heaven. God grant it for Jesus' sake. Amen. Also, a prayer of intercession and thanksgiving has been requested for Lindsay Rothy Spivey, her husband Josh, and her expectant child that's expected in the coming year, 2018. We bow our heads in prayer. Lord of life, we marvel again at the wonderful way in which you bring children into the world. We ask you to hold your protecting hand over this mother-to-be and for bringing joy to these parents, as well as grandparents, with the expectance of a child. Receive this child into your family through the sacrament of baptism, and protect this child from every danger of body and soul. Give the parents the love, wisdom, and means to care for this child. We ask this in the name of Jesus, our Savior, the friend of all children. Amen.
Thank you for spending some time with us today. You have been watching First Evangelical Lutheran Church of the Wisconsin Evangelical Lutheran Synod. Reverend Thomas Rothy invites you to tune in again next week, or if you have the opportunity, to worship with us live on Sunday morning at 9:30. First Evangelical Lutheran Church is located at 231 Smoke Tree Lane, Prescott, Arizona. If you are in need of spiritual assistance or would just like more information, please call 445-2807. May God's word guide you this week.